The lesson that I'm teaching you today is the same lesson that I teach the state legislators. The state legislators' lesson, oops, I forgot my stuff. I have a stack of books on the corner. Can I ask you to grab this for me? Okay. So, a man by the name of Curtis Oda, who's a legislator from the state of Utah, heard me speak at a constitutional sheriff's event. How many of you know about Sheriff Mac? Okay. So I speak and teach at Sheriff Mac's national conferences every year. And he heard me speak and he said, KrisAnne, I need you to come to Utah and teach our state legislators their constitutional duty and the role that they have based on the oath that they've taken to support and defend the Constitution of the United States. And so from that, I developed that invitation, I developed this lesson. And the lesson was so well received by the Utah legislators. I had not only taught members of the House and the Senate, but I also taught the Secretary of State and the Attorney General of Utah. Now, just because I taught them, how many of you realize, doesn't mean they learned anything. Okay? I'm just saying, I taught them, and you're going to see what they were taught. Whether they actually drank the water, I have no idea, okay? And so from that lesson, it was so well received, I wrote this book. And Curtis Oda gave me an endorsement of this book, said that he believed that every American should have these lessons. Why? Well, how many of you think the federal government is not working the way it's supposed to? All right, so how many of you think the federal government's completely out of control? Right. Now that's pretty obvious, I think, for the most of us who are critically thinking and watching what's going on and know even just a little bit about the Constitution. But you see, we see people on the news, we see people on the internet, we read articles, we listen to people on the radio shows, and they do a lot of complaining. A lot of blame game finger pointing. How many of you seen all that? Problem is that nobody is really talking about the solutions. I mean, we have this we can try, we can have that we can try, but what really are the solutions? Now I'm gonna tell you, my opinion about how we should fix this is completely irrelevant. You shouldn't care what my opinion is, which is why I'm not here to teach you my opinion. I'm going to teach you the facts from history and the facts from the men who lived that history and wrote our documents. Patrick Henry said, I have but one lamp by which my feet are guided, and that's the lamp of experience. I know no way to judge the future but by the past. We have a funny little saying, those who do not know their history are doomed to repeat it. Right? How many of you heard that? It's not entirely true. Because if that's true, then what Patrick Henry is saying is wrong. Because Patrick Henry is saying, I can know what my future holds by studying my past. Why? Because history always repeats. But those who do not know their history are doomed to repeat its mistakes. You see, when we learn from history, we can repeat the good stuff, but unfortunately, we don't. And of all places that our education is, is first and foremost revised, it's in history. Why do you think that is? Because when we put the government in charge of teaching our children, why would the government want us to know the mistakes in history and not repeat them? Because the mistakes in history always bring about bigger government and less liberty. And so what we need to do is pick up some history lessons and learn from our mistakes. Now I teach the 700 years that it took to write our Constitution. Our Constitution was not written in 1787. There is not anything new or novel in our Declaration of Independence, our Constitution, or our Bill of Rights. Everything within those three documents can be traced back to five documents that were written over 700 years. Our framers called them liberty charters. I call them the genealogy of our Constitution.
So if one of these five documents is missing, there is no Declaration of Independence, there is no Constitution, there is no Bill of Rights. And when I teach this, I teach it in about an hour and a half or a 6-hour workshop where I go through the history, and then I teach where our Bill of Rights came from, what they mean and how they're supposed to be applied, how we're doing it wrong and the solutions to making it right. And when you see that history, and I've done this for 4 years, you will be amazed at the precision with which we are repeating the mistakes of history. I'll just give you one for an example. The fourth document in the genealogy of our Constitution is a document called the Grand Remonstrance of 1641. The Grand Remonstrance of 1641 says, "The root of all this mischief we find to be a malignant and pernicious design subverting the fundamental laws and liberties of our kingdom." Now that sounds good if you were born in 1641, but for us, what that basically means is, hey, we've been watching tyrannical government for 600 years now, and we're noticing a pattern. The same bag of tricks over and over again. A wicked, evil plan whose only purpose is to overturn and undermine liberty. And then when you read the Grand Remonstrance, you see that design. Corruption of the court system. Infiltration of foreign law. The government diminishing the property rights of the people. The government taking control of the church. The government creating fiat money to control the monetary system, and the government disarming the people while the government remained armed. This was written in 1641, not 1941. See, there is nothing new under the sun. We are simply just the same human nature interacting with the same government over and over again. And the interesting thing is, our framers knew this history. Which is why they decided not to have a kingdom. I don't know if you remember from your history lesson, after our first independence war with Great Britain, people were begging George Washington to be king. How many of you remember that? Well, we need to thank God that there were some who said, hey, we've been doing the king thing now for 700 years, and we've learned something. Kings only keep their promises as long as you hold a sword at their throat. And the minute you take the sword down, kings go back to being kings, and people go back to being subjects. So why don't we not try to do the same thing over and over and expect different results? Let's build a place where liberty is preserved, has the opportunity to prosper, and the only form of government that we know on earth that can achieve that is a constitutional republic. And it's because of this history they knew that. Now, when you see the history and you see how it repeats and you understand what our framers understood, then it would not surprise you to know they anticipated the government we would have today. Remember in your history lesson, the story is told about the lady going up to Benjamin Franklin. What kind of government did you give us, Mr. Franklin? He replies, a republic, if you can keep it. Why? Because they knew history, and they knew human nature, and they knew how all these things interact with each other. And they knew there would quite possibly come a day if everything worked the way they wanted it to work, we would become prosperous. But they knew there's a danger in prosperity. People come pacified in prosperity. They become lazy in luxury. And that is the moment government is waiting for. Because when we get comfortable, government loves that. They come to us and say, isn't it so great that you're so comfortable? I mean, all this prosperity so much because of this prosperity, and we want you to be comfortable. As a matter of fact, we want you to have more comfort. And here's what we're willing to do for you, because you see, we realize that in order for you to have more comfort, that it makes sense for both parents in the family to work. And with both parents in the family working, you can amass more comfort. You can be more comfortable. You can do more things that you want to do. And you know, educating and raising those children, what a burden that is. You can't all work doing that. Don't worry about educating and raising your kids. We'll do that for you. Healthcare. What a burden to bear. What if you have an emergency? How do you prepare for that? How do you take care of yourself as you're aging with medical needs? Oh, don't worry about that. We'll take care of that for you.
And the interesting thing is, the more comfort government provides for you, the less liberty you have. And the more servitude we suffer from. And so our framers knew that we might become pacified in prosperity and lazy in luxury, and they anticipated that the federal government would leap out of its limited and defined box. And so within our constitutional republic, they placed a plan, a solution to getting the federal government back under control. The solution lies with understanding who the states are. So, what we're going to do is we're going to first talk to the legislators of the state of Virginia in 1799, who give us the very best definition, job description of your state legislator. Now, I want to mention to you, as just a matter of information, can you turn this mic down? Is that what you're trying to do back there? Okay, I need you to turn this mic down, way down. Whenever we talk about the duty of the state legislature in this presentation, I want you to understand that this is not a duty that is exclusive to the state legislators. This is a duty that applies to every single person in government who raises their hand to take an oath and says, I swear I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States from all enemies, foreign and domestic. So anybody who takes that oath, much better, thank you. Anybody who takes that oath has this responsibility. So what is the job description number one of your oath takers? They are to be not shrinking from their representative responsibilities, but guardians of the state sovereignty. That is job description number one of every person working in your state capital. Guardian of the state sovereignty. The problem is, those people working for your government within the state, your county commission, your city council, they think job description number one is economic improvement, right? Or security. Or education. No. Job description number one is to secure the sovereignty and guard the sovereignty of the states. If you do that, all those other things automatically fall into place. Why? Why do they have this responsibility to guard the state sovereignty? Why? Because they're acting under the oath, I do swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States. And we're going to learn this evening that if we do not guard the sovereignty of the states, the Constitution is destroyed. There is no republic if the states are not sovereign. Why do we have to guard the sovereignty of the states based on our oath? And how do we do that? Well, they said we are to guard the sovereignty of the states, keeping our oath, by warning you of federal encroachments. Imagine that. Your elected employees are supposed to warn you of federal encroachments, not compete for them.
Now, these legislators in 1799 recognized that that may not be an easy task, because these federal encroachments may be clothed with the pretext of necessity. Because, you know, we must have national health care. If we don't have national health care, we're all going to die. If you have news for you, we're all going to die. National health care just allows the federal government to decide when, where, and how you die. But it's necessary. They said not only will it be clothed with the pretext of necessity, but it will also be disguised by arguments of expediency. Because you know we have to pass the bill so we can read the bill. Now I'll remind you, this was written in 1799, not 1999. Why? Because history always repeats, and human nature never changes. So in order to understand the role of these guardians of the state's sovereignty, we must understand what is a state, what is the federal government, what is the Constitution, and what are the proper power roles between the feds and the states. Now, in order to do that, we're going to get back to some real basics. And when I mean basics, I mean real. ABC, 1, 2, 3 basics. How many of you looked at something for a long, long time and then all of a sudden one day something clicked? I think part of the reason why we're unaware of the solutions that we have to fix the federal government is because we have taken some things for granted. And so look, this is what we're first going to discuss. Which came first? The states or the federal government? I mean, that's a no-brainer, right? It's obvious. But let's look at the chronology of this, because this is very, very important. This is the detail of who came first that really, really makes the big difference. Who came first? Well, the states came first, obviously, but when did the states come? We are often taught that we became states on July 4th, 1776, with the signing of the Declaration of Independence. That's not true. We actually became states 2 days prior, when we ratified the Lee Resolution. The Lee Resolution was presented to the Continental Congress on June 7th by Richard Henry Lee, a representative of the state of Virginia. It was a modification of a resolution written by Virginia, in which it dictated a 3-step process to becoming independent from Great Britain. The Lee Resolution stated step number 1, we are independent from Great Britain, because we say so. Because we are not colonists and we don't need permission from the king. We are people and endowed by our creator with these rights, so we don't need anybody's permission. Step number 2, we must immediately form foreign alliance. Contrary to what we may have been taught, our battle did not begin on July 4th. By the time we signed the Declaration of Independence, we'd already been on the battlefield with bullets and battle plans for over 2 years. The Declaration of Independence was not the beginning of our battle. The Declaration of Independence was the last move in reconciliation. A list of grievances against the king saying, hey, this is your last chance to make things right. If you fail to make things right, then we are going to exert our right to alter and abolish. So they knew they did not have enough money or resources to kick Great Britain off the land. Step number 3, we must immediately form a confederation to protect the liberty we will, and the independence we will be winning. And on July 2nd, 1776, the Continental Congress debated, voted, and ratified into law the Lee Resolution, making 13 independent, free, and sovereign states. Our independence from Great Britain was not some random act of rogue rebels, a bunch of rich white guys who wanted to avoid paying their taxes. That's what the Common Core textbooks are teaching, by the way, I've read that. Our independence from Great Britain
was a constitutionally, I'm sorry, it was a congressionally voted, debated, and ratified law, just as legally binding as anything that our Congress does today that's constitutional. Which means our states existed prior to the Declaration of Independence by 2 days. Our first attempt at that confederation, step number 3 of the Lee Resolution, was the Articles of Confederation. And it wasn't until the Articles of Confederation that we finally have an executive branch, a legislative branch, and a judicial branch. And in these Articles of Confederation, we created a central government. Unfortunately, or fortunately, however you will look at it, we created a central government so small it could not function. And when it was functioning, it wasn't functioning properly. It didn't understand its proper role. And so, we had to move on to the Constitution, the more perfect union. Now the interesting thing, because we're tracing here the chronology of the states and where the feds come in. The interesting thing is, in this blank space right here, we dissolved the Articles of Confederation, which means we dissolved the federal government. So in this blank space here, there is no federal government. So what is the only form of government that exists? The states. Which means the states are the only government that's standing exists prior to the Constitution. So now we know the states are the only form of government that exists right now prior to the formation of the Constitution. Now we need to know, what is the Constitution? Very simply spoken, the Constitution is a contract. Our framers will call it a compact, more specifically, because it is an agreement between sovereign governments. An agreement between sovereign governments is called a compact. An agreement between people is called a contract. Now, I'll use the word contract because it's something that's familiar to us, and frankly, it really doesn't matter in this context because they both work the same way. Each contract has basically two sides. The parties who create the contract and the product that is created by the contract. So, the parties to the contract can be only one group of people. The only form of government that existed was the states. The states are the party to the contract, which means the federal government is what? The product. Somebody's going to try to tell you that the Constitution is an agreement between the people and the federal government. That's not true. It's impossible. The Constitution was not ratified by popular vote. The individual people had no vote in it. The Constitution was ratified by their representatives through the states, which tells us that the states are the parties to the contract. Someone might try to tell you more accurately that the Constitution is an agreement between the states and the federal government. But that's a temporal impossibility, because the states are the parties to the contract and the federal government is the product. You cannot be the party to a contract if you are the product of the contract, because you don't exist until the contract is signed. So you can't sign it. And, as we'll learn in a few minutes, in order to be a party to a contract, you must be sovereign. Your 15-year-old child or grandchild cannot legally make a contract, because your 15-year-old is not sovereign in the eyes of the law. He is subject to his parents. And the federal government can't be a party to the contract, because the federal government has no sovereignty. Sovereignty only exists within the states and the people themselves. So now that we know what the Constitution is, we need to understand what is a state. So this is the last paragraph to the Declaration of Independence.
which, by the way, is nearly verbatim to the first clause of the Lee resolution. We, therefore, the representatives of the United States of America, in General Congress assembled, let me point out something to you, because let me just mention to you, I'm not here to teach you tonight. I'm not here to entertain you. I'm here to recruit you. This is not just some amusing teaching lesson. This is constitutional defense boot camp. I am hoping to prepare you with the truth that will infuse you with the courage to stand in public in the face of people who are going to tell you lies about the Constitution. And I want to prepare you to respond to the lies that I have heard. I haven't heard them all, I'm sure, but I've heard a good number of them. And somebody's going to say to you, well, our framers envisioned the federal government when they wrote the Declaration of Independence, and power was envisioned to the federal government through the Declaration of Independence, because after all, it says the United States of America. Problem is, grammar doesn't support that. See that U? That U is not capitalized. United States of America is not a proper noun here. The only proper noun is States of America. That word united is an adjective to describe the condition of the states being united in this declaration. We, therefore, the representatives of the United States in America, in General Congress assembled, appealing to the Supreme Judge of the world for the rectitude of our intentions, do, in the name and by the authority of the who? People. See, this is a really big distinction, and this is going to tick off the king really bad. Because you don't do anything by the authority of the people. These were colonies in a kingdom. They do nothing by the authority of the people. The only authority that exists in a kingdom is the king. And so now they're declaring that we have the authority to do this. And by the authority of the good people of these colonies, we solemnly publish and declare. See, we didn't become. We simply published and declared what we did 2 days prior. That these united colonies are, and of right ought to be, what? Free and independent states. Now we know from this last clause that there's a change going on. We went from colonies to states, which by logic means there's a difference between a colony and a state, right? A colony is not free and independent. A colony does nothing outside the permission of the king, but we are no longer colonies, we are a state, and this state, these states, are free and independent. But what is this word state mean? Well, we'll continue with the last paragraph of the Declaration of Independence. Free and independent states, that they are absolved from all allegiance to the British Crown, what is a state? And that all political connection between them and what? State of Great Britain. That word state is not simply synonymous with Delaware, New York, and Rhode Island. That word state is synonymous with France, Spain, and Great Britain. That word state means independent, sovereign country. Just to see that I'm not lying to you, and for our framers to prove exactly what a state is, they say that these free and independent states, they have, look at this power, our states have full power to levy war, conclude peace, contract alliances, establish commerce, and to do all other acts and things which independent states may of right do. Every power that Great Britain had, every power that France has, every power that Germany, Spain, any country on this planet has, rests in each individual state. And that's never changed. Delaware is still a free and independent state. Pennsylvania is still a free and independent state. Nothing has changed. Now somebody's going to try to tell you,
Well, that doesn't apply to the states that came after the first 13, which is not true. Even the Supreme Court says that's not true. The Supreme Court operates under a doctrine called the Equal Footing Doctrine. The Equal Footing Doctrine says every state that enters the Union enters on the same footing as the first 13, and there is that footprint. Somebody's going to say, well, that doesn't apply to Pennsylvania anymore because we formed a union. And when we formed a union, the states surrendered their sovereignty. Seriously? Isn't there a country called Germany? Didn't Germany join the European Union? Yes. So fly over to Germany and tell the German chancellor and the German people that Germany is no longer a sovereign country because they joined the EU. How do you think that's going to go over there? I mean, we laugh and we should, yeah, right, never. So why do we accept it here? Why do we quietly submit to a federal kingdom thinking that we're colonies? Well, I want you to sort of put a mental pin in this, because this is going to come up. These words, war, peace, alliances, commerce, these words are going to come up again, and we're going to need to know where they came from. So who holds this power right now, July 4th, 1776? States. So now we know the nature of the Constitution, and that the states are the creators of the contract. The states are the creators of the central government. They enumerated its specific powers. They created a limited central government. And here is probably the most important thing that they did. Reserved all other powers to themselves. What powers? What is the placement of power? Well, James Madison tells us in Federalist Papers 45, the powers delegated by the proposed Constitution to the federal government are few and defined. We made a box for the federal government with few and defined sides. He says, now this is important, those which are to remain in the state governments are numerous and indefinite. Now, everywhere you look, when our framers talk, and even within the Constitution itself, it talks about power being delegated to the federal government. Now, if something is delegated, that means there has to be a delegator and a delegate, right? Somebody to give and somebody to receive. Who's the giver and who's the receiver? Well, we know because the powers are delegated to the feds, so they are the receivers. But now we're told the powers are remaining in the states. That word remain means they all started there, right? So what left was delegated to, which means the states must be the givers. Well, we'll see this even more right here. Now, James Madison is not going to let us wait for the Supreme Court to define limited and defined. He's going to go ahead and tell us. He says, the former, the powers delegated by the proposed Constitution to the federal government, will be exercised principally on external objects. That's founders speak for foreign affairs. And then he tells us what those foreign affairs are. War, peace, negotiation, foreign commerce. Where did we see those words before? The last paragraph of the Declaration of Independence, right? The power that the states held. Where is this power coming from to the feds? The states. The states are the delegators, and the feds are the delegates. Now look, this tells us that the only power delegated to the federal government by the states through the Constitution are powers that relate to foreign affairs, specifically war, peace, negotiation, and foreign commerce. Look what Madison does. The powers
reserved to the several states will extend to all the objects which in the ordinary course of affairs concern the lives, liberties, properties of the people, internal order, improvement, and prosperity of the state. He's just simply explaining that the only thing that we ever delegated to the federal government was foreign affairs, war, peace, negotiation, and foreign commerce. Everything else is reserved to the states. Now that's a very important word. That word reserved is the same word that is used in the 10th Amendment to describe the power that belongs to the states. The power is not delegated to the United States, are reserved to the states or to the people. Which means, if there is federal government doing something besides war, peace, negotiation, and foreign commerce, where does that power have to be coming from? They're stealing power from the states. Is healthcare war, peace, negotiation, or foreign commerce? Is education war, peace, negotiation, or foreign commerce? Land management, forestry services, EPA, food and drug, Department of Homeland Security. By the very name, it's something that's to be reserved to the states. I love this. The Department of Interior. There absolutely is no department any more unconstitutional than one called the Department of Interior, because that is a power reserved to the states. Thomas Jefferson is telling us what happens when the federal government steals power from the states. Whenever the general government assumes undelegated powers, its acts are unauthoritative, void, and of no force. You know what he's describing? If you steal something, you have no legal authority over it. If I steal your car, do I have the legal authority to sell it? If I sell your car that I've stolen from you, is that sale have any legal power associated with it? No. And if I steal your car, do you have to sue me to get your car back? No. You simply provide the title deed and the car comes back to you. The poor sap who bought the stolen car is the one who's got to fight to get his money back. Undelegated power is stolen power. If the feds are stealing power from the states, do they have any legal authority to wield it? Anything that they do with that power, does it have legal force? No. Do the states have to sue the federal government to get their power back? No, they simply have to show the title deed to their power. And what is the title deed to their power?
Constitution.
Constitution. Void and of no force. It's when the EPA is trying to stand in your state and tell you how to run your water, your state has the authority to say, that has no legal authority here because it's stolen power. We don't recognize it. Get out. If the federal government uses a power outside of the Constitution, it has to steal that power from the states, or embezzle it, or extort it. Some people say, well, the feds aren't stealing power from the states, they're buying it with federal dollars. No, they're not. It's called extortion. Because number one, they stole the money from the states through an improper taxation, an unconstitutional taxation system, and now they're coercing the states out of their power with extortion of their own money. Now, this isn't the first time we are dealing with a federal government out of control. It happened in 1799 and 1800, it happened again in 1831, and John Calhoun is addressing this in 1831. He's telling us something very, very important here, an illustration that we must see. The doctrine which denies the states the right of protecting their reserved powers. Remember that word reserved is very important. And let's look at that. If this chair right here, sitting in between these two gentlemen, has a sign on it that says, reserved for KrisAnne Hall. Can anybody else sit in there? If someone else is sitting in that chair that says reserved for KrisAnne Hall, what do I have the power to do? Kick them out, right? Now let me ask you this question. If the chair says reserved for KrisAnne Hall and someone else is sitting in that chair and I don't have the power or the authority to kick them out, is the chair really reserved? No. That's what Calhoun is saying. That the fact that the power is reserved to the state means that there is an inherent right of the state to secure and protect what has been reserved to them. Because if it's not, if they don't have the power to protect that, then the power is not reserved. And the Constitution is lying. And so is James Madison. Not only that, if the states do not have the authority to secure unto themselves what has been reserved to them, then the states are not sovereign. Why? Because if the federal government can say, we're just going to use that power, and we're going to use that power, and you're going to take it, and you're going to like it, then we don't have sovereignty, do we? We're just subjects to whatever the federal government wants. And he says, not only will the states not have sovereignty, but the Constitution itself is destroyed. Why? Because the states are the parties to the Constitution. In order to be a party to a contract, you must be sovereign. The Constitution creates a limited and defined federal government, reserving all the rest of the powers to the states. And if the states are not sovereign, then the federal government is not limited, and the Constitution doesn't even legally exist. The designed solution placed within the Constitutional Republic to get the federal government under control, James Madison tells us about it in 1798. In the case of deliberate, palpable, and dangerous exercise of other powers not granted, who? The states have the right. Why? Because the power is reserved. And are duty bound. Why are they duty bound? Why? What does the Declaration of Independence say the power, the authority comes from? God. The people, right? By and through the authority of the people of these colonies. They are duty bound to the people because the people, in delegating this enormous power to the states, comes enormous responsibility to the people who have entrusted them with it. My son is 9 years old, and he's a Spider-Man fan. And he likes to quote Spider-Man, and Spider-Man's uncle said to Spider-Man one day, with great power comes great responsibility. That's what Madison is saying here. We have delegated great power to the states, and they are duty-bound to interpose, to step between the federal government and the people to secure the rights of the people, the liberties of the people, and the reserved powers of the states. Thomas Jefferson tells us in 1799, the several states who formed the Constitution, see, I'm not lying, being what? And? Independent, look at that. Have the unquestionable right to judge of its infractions. And that a nullification by those sovereignties, who are the sovereignties? Of all unauthorized acts done under the color of that instrument is the rightful remedy. Now, how many, I'm in a JBS meeting, you guys know about nullification, right?
Right.
Is there anybody here that has never heard of nullification as it applies to a power of the states? All right. How do I word this? Let's see. How many of you have personally spoken to someone in your state legislature about nullification? Okay, so this is for the rest of you who have not. Because I am an original text historian. I do not read other people's books on history. Everything that I teach you, everything that you find in my books on the back table, are put together because I have read the documents myself, not because I've read somebody's opinion about the documents. And when I came across this understanding of nullification, I got really excited. Because it's simple. It's not even just simple, it's constitutional. It's legal. It follows contract law principles. And I started wondering, this is it. Why aren't we doing this? Why isn't everybody doing this? I mean, we did it before. Why aren't we doing it now? And so I marched myself up to a Senate. I live in the state of Florida. And I marched myself up to a Senate judicial meeting. They were meeting on the establishment of the healthcare exchanges. And I signed up for my time. How many of you done this? Signed up for your time to speak at the committee meeting. And the interesting thing is, we didn't plan it this way, but it was a really packed out meeting. There were a lot of people there. And you guys don't know me, but in Florida, everybody knows me. And so when they saw me there, they signed up for their time. And when they were called, they said, by Robert's rules, we defer our time to KrisAnne Hall. So by the time I stood up, I had literally over 30 minutes to speak. Now, I wasn't going to take 30 minutes because I didn't come prepared for that. But nonetheless, I had time. Now, I stood up there and my little prepared presentation on what? Nullification. It went over like a lead balloon. Now, each person got 3 minutes. Now, remember, I had more, but at about a minute and a half, they had had enough. The chairman's going, Ms. Hall, we got to wrap up. And I'm like, what? He says, you only get 3 minutes. I said, no, sir, I don't. I said, by Robert's rules, I have at least 30 minutes. I'm not going to take 30 minutes, but by Robert's rules, I have at least 30 minutes. You have to recognize that. Well, we've got a lot of people and everybody wants to be heard. I said, well, that's fine. I'm not going to take my 30 minutes, but I will finish. And so I kept talking. It did not go over well. You can go on my website and see the video from the cameras. You know, the sun, we call them sunshine laws. We have to camera video all this stuff. And you see what happened at one point in time. You know, my husband thought I was going to be carted off by the guards, and it was just not. Anyway, but the real excitement started after the meeting. Because after the meeting, our Senate president, named Don Gates, came into the meeting. He wasn't there for the meeting. He came in to shake hands and kiss babies, right? Somebody said, hey, KrisAnne, I want you to meet our Senate president, Don Gates. Now, I was pretty excited about it because I'd always been told that Don Gates was a constitutional historian and that he was a conservative Republican. So I was really excited about meeting him. I said, hey, Mr. Gates, it's really nice to meet you. He said, oh, Ms. Hall, it's fantastic. I said, really, Mr. Gates? I hope we'll see more of each other. He said, oh, Ms. Hall, that'd be really nice. I said, you think so, Mr. Gates? Because I'd love to come and talk to the Senate about nullification. You'd have thought I slapped him in the face with a wet fish. He took 2 steps back and cocked his hip and said, nullification, huh? I guess the Supreme Court didn't get your memo. I said, my memo? I guess they didn't get Madison, Hamilton, or Jefferson's memo then either, did they? He said, Madison, huh? Been holding seances? Talk to Madison lately? No, I'm green, okay? I'm green. I've never done this before. I don't expect. The things that are run through my head are not very nice. Because my first thought is, that guy works for me. Why is he talking to me like that? And I said, well, responded, well, as a matter of fact, I have. It's called the Federalist Papers, and maybe you ought to read them every now and again. At which point he realizes that I'm not the average bear, and I'm not gonna back down. So he turns his back on me, walks away waving his hand, mumbling things about dead people in irrelevant documents. Now, I don't know about you, but when I get in situations like that, I get tunnel vision. And so as far as I'm concerned, Mr. Gates and I are the only two people in the room. And he's walking out the door. And so he gets about as far away from me as the man there in the burgundy striped tie. And I yell at him. I raise my voice and I yell at him. I said, hey, Mr. Gates, I thought you called yourself a constitutional conservative Republican. At which point he spins on his heels and points at me, scowling with his face. I took an oath to support and defend the Constitution of the United States. I said, well, maybe it's about time you learned something about that document, don't you think? At which point Gates figures out something that I don't know. We are not the only two people in the room. As a matter of fact, we've just come from a hotly contested Senate Judiciary meeting. There is a whole crowd of people standing behind me watching this, some of them reporters with cameras. His whole demeanor changes. Oh, Miss Hall, I'd be happy to read anything you have to send me. Just send me an email. So I did. I wrote a little primer on nullification. It's in the appendix of my book, Sovereign Duty, Nullification in a Nutshell. I sent it to him. He sent me back an email telling me that he thought that I should be shot or hanged for asserting that the states have a power greater than the federal government. Now, the Huffington Post confronted him. He said, well, of course I didn't mean that we should be shooting or hanging people. I just wanted Miss Hall to realize that we could disagree and still remain civil. I'm not making that up. It's in writing. What do you think would have happened if I'd have wrote Don Gaines a letter and telling him that I thought he should be shot or hanged for not defending the sovereignty of the states? I just want to warn you. Before you go up and talk to your people, our governments have been taken over by federal supremacists. And if you're not careful, these federal supremacists will want to lynch you. So you must teach them sovereignty first. That's why we are into this presentation before we even talk about nullification. Now that we know nullification is our remedy, nullification is the states standing up and saying, hey, you stole our car. You don't have the authority to use it. You don't have the authority to drive it. We're taking it back. It doesn't take any lawsuits. It simply takes the states standing up and saying, see this contract? It declares that these are the powers that are delegated to you. And if they're not expressly and specifically delegated to you, they are reserved to us, which means you can't use them. And even though you may have been for a while, it's not been legally, and now we're taking them back. That's it. It's that simple. You deny the federal government stolen power in your state. Now, some people are going to tell you nullification is not allowed. They'll tell you the Supreme Court said no. They'll tell you the Supremacy Clause prohibits it. That's my favorite one. They'll tell you it's not in the Constitution. The Supreme Court said no. Well, let's look at that for a second. James Madison will disagree because James Madison says, and I love this because this is so on point, if the decisions of the judiciary be raised above the authority of the sovereign parties to the Constitution, who are the sovereign parties of the Constitution? If the decisions of the judiciary be raised above the authority of the states, dangerous powers not delegated may not only be usurped and executed by other departments, but that the Judicial Department also may exercise or sanction dangerous powers beyond the grant of the Constitution. See, it doesn't take the Supreme Court exercising power. They can just simply say, oh yeah, healthcare is a power quite rightly wielded by the federal government, and then they're sanctioning a power that doesn't belong. And that puts them superior to the states. And Madison says you can't do that. He says, consequently, the ultimate right of the parties to the Constitution, who are the parties to the Constitution?
States.
The ultimate right of the states to judge whether the compact, the Constitution, has been dangerously violated must extend to violations by one delegated authority as well as by another, by the judiciary as well as by the executive or the legislative. Madison is just very simply reminding us, how many branches of government do we have?
Three.
We have the legislative, the executive, and? So are we all in unanimous agreement that the judicial branch is part of the federal government? Madison is simply saying, you cannot let part of the whole define the power of the whole, because then the whole has no limit at all. They will just simply define their power as they wish. And in order to change that and control that, it's the states who created the whole that have the authority over it. Now, naysayers will tell you, well, that's a real convenient phrase by James Madison. Problem is, James Madison is a stupid idiot and he's confused and he contradicts himself. They probably won't call him a stupid idiot, but that's exactly what they're saying. Because they'll point out this thing in 1789 to contradict what Madison said in 1800. The problem is, the 1800 speech and the 1789 speech were dealing with two completely different topics. In 1789, Madison is presenting to the House of Representatives regarding the incorporation of the Bill of Rights into the Constitution. Now, there is an argument against incorporating the Bill of Rights into the Constitution. And the argument says, if we make a list of rights, the government will use that list to take our rights away. We'll make a list, we won't be able to put them all on the list. It won't be an exhaustive list. There's no way we can make an exhaustive list. So the government will say, hey, you made this really nice list, these things must be important, but that's not on the list, so it must mean for us to be able to regulate it. Or they'll say, hey, you know, it's on the list, we certainly don't want to infringe, abridge, or violate it, but we have to know what it is, right? Freedom of the press. We're not supposed to abridge that, but what is press? I mean, if we don't know what it is, we might accidentally abridge it. And so in order to not abridge it, we have to define it. Hamilton said there is no way to define liberty without establishing a way to evade it. Because they'll say this is obviously press. But this is not press. And since this is not press, it's not on the list. You know, this internet thing, because they didn't have internet when they wrote the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, so this is clearly not press. So it's not press, it's not on the list. You must be okay for us to regulate it. Madison agrees that this is a really, really good argument against putting the Bill of Rights into the Constitution. But Madison has made a promise to the people of Virginia that they will get their Bill of Rights. And so he comes to the people, the representatives, and say, look, I can guarantee you that if we incorporate this Bill of Rights into the Constitution, it will be protected. Why? He said, if they are incorporated, the Bill of Rights, into the Constitution, independent tribunals of justice will consider themselves in a peculiar manner the guardian of those rights. They will be an impenetrable bulwark against every assumption of power in the legislative or executive. They will be naturally led to resist every encroachment upon the rights expressly stipulated for in the Constitution by the Declaration of Rights. Now, what Madison is saying here is, if we put this Bill of Rights into the Constitution, they will be safe because the courts will be in a unique position to protect them. Why? Well, because Madison knows what you now know. The Constitution is a contract. And in order to operate a contract, you have to follow contract law. And contract law dictates certain processes on the judicial system if anything within that contract comes into question. Rule number one, if you don't understand how a provision works or how a word is defined, contract law says you have to go not to the courts, not to the judges, not to the lawyers, but to the ones who drafted the contract. It's a legal term called the meeting of the minds. The meeting of the minds is the legal point in the contract where the drafters of the contract sat down and discussed the provisions of the contract, what they mean, why they're there, and all that stuff. And Madison is simply saying, because we know the Constitution is a contract, if in the future they don't know what press is, because of contract law, they will have to come to us for the definition of press, which means they'll have to come to our meeting of the minds. They'll come to our Federalist Papers, our Anti-Federalist Papers, the notes from the debates, and the letters that we wrote to each other. The irony in that? The Constitution is the only contract in the United States where judges and lawyers refuse to apply contract law. Go to any lawyer or judge and tell them that you're going to negotiate their contract as a living, breathing document and see how willing they are to accept that for an employment contract. Well, you might have a problem then, I mean even a little bit, with the faith that Madison's putting in the courts if you stop right here. But this is not the end of Madison's thought. Because Madison continues and says, besides the security of the courts, there is a great probability that such a declaration in the federal system would be enforced because the state legislatures will jealously and closely watch the operations of this, the federal government, and be able to resist with more effect every assumption of power that any other power on earth can do. And the greatest opponent to a federal government admit the state legislatures to be the sure guardians of the people's liberty. Your state legislators are supposed to be in an adversarial relationship with the federal government. They are supposed to be the greatest opponents to the federal government, not their best friends, and not agencies that simply do work for them. They're supposed to be guarding the state's sovereignty. They're supposed to be guarding your liberty through the state's sovereignty. And they're supposed to be opposing the federal government's operation contrary to that. The Supremacy Clause prohibits it. Hamilton disagrees. Hamilton says in Federalist Paper 78, no legislative act contrary to the Constitution can be valid. Now I know the framers can be hard to read and understand sometimes, but I don't think that comes any clearer. Not only that, the framers have a unique way of giving us a principle and then telling us what will happen if we ignore that principle. And Hamilton is telling us no legislative act contrary to the Constitution can be valid. And if we allow legislative acts contrary to the Constitution to be valid, then we will assert that the deputy is greater than his principal and that the servant is above his master. Do you see that relationship there? The federal government is supposed to be deputy to the state principal and servant to the state master. And he said, it won't be long if we continue to do this before the representatives of the people are superior to the people themselves. Isn't that the way they act now? Well, it's because we have allowed legislative acts contrary to the Constitution to be valid for so long. You see, we are the Constitution. And when we allow the federal government to become superior to the Constitution, to do things contrary to it, then we allow them to be superior to us. And you wonder why they ignore us. Let's look at the Supremacy Clause. This Constitution and the laws of the United States, which shall be made in pursuance thereof, these dot, dot, dots have language about treaties, that's a whole nother lesson, we're not gonna cover treaties today, shall be the supreme law of the land. Well, let's look at this grammatically, because it's very powerful when you do that. See this comma right here, and these clauses, they're actually independent. You can take them apart, and it says, this Constitution shall be the supreme law of the land. That's one statement. The other is, the laws of the United States which shall be made in pursuance thereof shall be the supreme law of the land. And when you read it like that, it really, really jumps out at you. You see, the Constitution is the supreme law of the land without any qualifier at all. It's the Constitution, so it's supreme. However, the laws of the United States, meaning laws made by Congress, are only the supreme law of the land when they are made in pursuance to the Constitution. Because the laws must be inferior to the Constitution. You can't have laws being supreme and the Constitution being supreme at the same time. Because then they can write laws that contradict the Constitution, then the Constitution's not supreme anymore, right? There's a hierarchy. And it's exactly what Hamilton was saying. No legislative act contrary to the Constitution can be valid. Not in the Constitution. Well, that's good news. Because remember, if it's not specifically delegated to the United States by the Constitution, then it is reserved to the states. And so if nullification is not in the Constitution, then it's reserved to who? The states. But the problem is, it is in the Constitution by principle, but that doesn't change the fact that it's reserved to the states. Remember, who had the authority to create the states? The people. That's what the Ninth Amendment says. By the way, just a little bit of bonus for your educational dollar. The Ninth Amendment is the most important clause in the entire Constitution and Bill of Rights. There is nothing in the Constitution or the Bill of Rights more important than the Ninth Amendment. It's the Ninth Amendment that makes us a republic and not a kingdom. It's the Ninth Amendment that declares all the rights in the universe belong to us. And then the Tenth Amendment comes along and explains that only power is delegated to government. And so because we have the authority to create the state, and the states then, being sovereign by our authority, created the Constitution. We know that they are the creators and they have the authority to protect what is reserved to them. And that's exactly what nullification is. The authority to protect what is reserved to you. Because without nullification, the power is not reserved. You have to run to the federal government and sue them. What happens when you sue the federal government? What you're basically doing is asking them permission and approval to get your power back. If the federal government is not defined by the Constitution, then why do we have one? If the federal government is not limited in its power by the Constitution, then what is the limit to the federal government's power? Well, there is no limit, save the states. Because when the federal government refuses to follow the supreme law of the land, they are operating lawlessly. And it is up to the states to hold them to the law, defending the Constitution, which defends the Republic. Because if the Constitution does not operate, to limit the government, and the government is unlimited, then we are not a republic, we are a totalitarian kingdom. We are just simply colonies. Justice Roberts supports nullification, by the way. Shows you that the Supreme Court's doing, even put it in a Supreme Court opinion. This is an excerpt from his opinion on the Affordable Care Act. Now that is a horribly written Supreme Court opinion. I have read hundreds of Supreme Court opinions, and it was difficult for me to follow his non-logic. But when I came across this phrase down there, I'll read it to you. It's probably so small you can't read it. I nearly fell out of my chair. I actually stood up and clapped. My husband's like, "What is going on?" I said, "You've got to read this." Robert says, "We look to the states to defend their prerogatives by adopting the simple expedient of not yielding to federal blandishments when they do not want to embrace federal policies as their own." And then he says, "The command and the call that every state should wake up to. The states are separate and independent sovereigns. Sometimes they have to act like it." So the dirty little secret that your federal supremacist will throw in your face is nullification doesn't work. That was settled in the Civil War, ignoring, of course, that this nullification was used in the Civil War to nullify federal enforcement of the Slave Act. The 10th Amendment Center tracks all nullification legislation. There are over 300 pieces of legislation right now have either been passed into law or are currently under consideration. I taught in Grant County, Oregon, because nullification is not just a state thing. Remember, I told you, everything that we taught here is not only something that your state uses, but that your county can use, and your city council, and your sheriff. Grant County, Oregon has passed two ordinances. One ordinance declaring that Grant County is a UN-free zone. The other ordinance declared any federal road closures to be illegal. As a matter of fact, they joined up with a neighboring county to protest a road closure in a neighboring county because the feds, see, this is the thing, the feds don't test these things. Because the other dirty little secret is that the feds don't have the manpower or the resources to enforce their mandates. They rely on co-opting the local governments to do it for them. And so they don't test these things. I mean, after all, Kansas passed a law that said any federal gun law in the state of Kansas is now null and void. And any federal agent trying to enforce a federal gun law in the state of Kansas will be prosecuted under a violation of state law to the highest degree of the law. Eric Holder sent Kansas a threatening letter. What kind of guy do you have to be to have the nerve to threaten an entire state? Well, the governor and the secretary of state sent Eric Holder back a letter. Said, "You know, we happen to know that Kansas is a sovereign state. We also understand the Second Amendment and our obligation to defend the Second Amendment rights of our people. So it's unfortunate that you disagree with us, but we're not changing our minds. And if you think you can do anything about that, why don't you just come on over and try?" So did you guys see the federal, the Department of Justice and their SWAT teams moving into Kansas to take over? Of course not. Because the federal government is a schoolyard bully, all bark and no bite. Now, when you go to your state, county, or city government and say, "Look, we are sick and tired of being subjects of the federal government, We are sick and tired of having all of these federal fundings tying us into slavery to the federal machine. We want to be independent, we want to be free, and we want to be prosperous within our own communities outside federal regulation and rule. We want you to refuse all this federal encroachments. The first thing you're going to hear is, how will we run our hospitals without federal funding? How will we run our schools? We won't have any health care. Our roads will fall apart without federal money. You know what they're telling you? It's just too inconvenient to do what's right. It's too much trouble to do what's right. They're not acknowledging that it's right, that it's wrong. They're saying it's too much trouble to do what's right. Hamilton has a word for that. Is it not better, I ask, to suffer a few present inconveniences than to put yourselves in the way of losing everything that is precious? Your lives, health care. Your property, Department of Interior, Bureau of Land Management, IRS, and the Health Care Act. Your religion, the IRS, the Health Care Act. He says they're all at stake. I do my duty, I warn you of your danger. If you should still be so mad as to bring destruction upon yourselves, if you should still neglect what you owe to God and man, you cannot plead ignorance in your excuse. Your consciences will reproach you for your folly, and your children's children will curse you. Because it's not about us. Liberty is not a gift that you secure for yourself. Liberty is a gift that we're responsible to pay forward, and we're failing miserably. We now live in a society that is comfortable with unlimited government regulation. From the milk and the cereal that we drink in the morning to the beds and the sheets that we sleep in at night, and now the Supreme Court says the federal government can even regulate our air and water. And we're raising a generation of people who will not only be comfortable with unlimited government regulation, but also comfortable with unlimited government surveillance. We have a responsibility to change that. So I want to ask you one question. What do you want your legacy to be? Are you satisfied with the status quo? Then just keep electing the same people and keep doing the same things. Satisfied with recognizing the path that our children will have to trot? Okay. But if you're not, if you don't want our children to curse us through history for having to fight to get back a liberty that we were supposed to give to them, then we've given you the plan. Hamilton says, I've done my duty. We've warned you of the danger. They've shown you the way to go. And all you have to do is do it. Mercy Otis Warren said, we will stand against tyranny today, or our children will bow tomorrow. How many of you can think of at least three people who should have been sitting next to you today? How many of you like to have your state legislators learn this lesson? Well, this is Curtis Oda. You can invite me back to teach them, or you can take a legislator a copy of this book. This is what Oda said about this book and the lesson that I taught you today. This book has chapters on has my nullification primer in the back. It has explanations of nullification in it. It talks about the sovereignty of the states. It talks about the role of a sheriff throughout history and today. It talks about the role of your legislators, what the Constitution is, how the contract is supposed to work. It talks about the right to keep and bear arms and our right and duty to resist unlawful actions of the federal government. Now I want to show you something about this book, because this is not an, just like this presentation was not opinion-based, the book is not opinion-based. This is a fact-based book, and I want you to be secure in that. Every single quote and every document referenced is cited in the back of the book to its original source text. So you can go and read the entire document that I've pulled the text from and see if I've taken it out of context and I'm misapplying it. Because I am not here to sell you deception. I am here to provide you with tools to stand in defense of liberty for our children. I will come back and teach your legislators the same way I teach every group. This is how you find me. I'm sorry, you have to ignore the 66866 thing. I forgot to take that off. That's a thing that we had going to get my ebook In Defense of Liberty for free. We're not doing that thing anymore, so I gotta remember to take that off. But I have books on the back table. I have the Sovereign Duty book that I taught the lesson from today. This is a 3-DVD set of a lesson that I teach. It's a 6-hour workshop, actually 5 hours of teaching, but the DVD sets have more teaching than I give in the average workshop. So the DVDs have almost 6 hours of teaching on 3 DVDs, chaptered out in 40-minute sections, so you don't have to watch the whole thing all at one time. This teaches the 700 years that it took to write the Constitution that I told you about, the 5 Liberty Charters. And then I walk through the Bill of Rights 1 through 10, show you where they came from, what they mean, how they're supposed to work, and what we're doing wrong, and what to do to make it right. I also have something that I don't usually have. I have the workbooks that go along with the DVD set that I use when I teach the workshop live. So the DVD set is a live presentation taped. And we have the workbooks back there too. So if you want to take the DVD set and actually use it like a lesson, you can take the workbooks with you too to help take notes. I have this book back there, Liberty First, The Path to Restoring America. This is Constitutional Activism 101. How to use the First Amendment as a tool to preserve liberty. How many of you realize we're not teaching our kids in school what they're supposed to be learning about the Constitution? Okay. That's why I wrote these two books. The purple book is for high school and middle school students. The blue book is for everybody younger, from the womb up, we say. And what this teaches is the 700 years of history that I teach in the workshop. And then has chapters on founders and framers that they don't get to hear about by anybody else. How many of you know the name of the first man to die in our independence movement? Crispus Attucks. Everybody know Crispus Attucks? Crispus Attucks was a freed slave who had become a whaler for the merchant marines. He heard an alarm go off on his ship, ran up deck to put out the fire, only to find out there was no fire, but that his own government had picked up arms against his own people. It is March 5th, 1770. Crispus Attucks ran back below deck, got 55 of his shipmates, and came out and gave his life for us. There's a poem written about Crispus Attucks in his day by a man named John Boyle O'Reilly. Honor to Crispus Attucks, who was leader and voice that day. The first to defy and the first to die with Maverick, Carr, and Gray. Call it riot or revolution, his hand first clenched at the crown. His feet were the first in perilous place to pull the king's flag down. His breast was the first one rent apart that liberty's stream might flow. For our freedom now and forever, his head was first laid low. Call it riot or revolution, or mob or crowd as you may. Such deaths have been seed of nations. Such lives shall be honored for a. How many of you the first time you've heard about Crispus Attucks? They thought in his day that we would be remembering and honoring him forever. And we don't even know his name. Ned Hector. Anybody heard of Ned Hector? Peter Salem, Penelope Barker, Mercy Otis Warren, James Otis Jr., Richard Henry Lee. All these people are essential to who we are. We would not be here today if it were not for them. And I think we need to remember them for that. I teach across the country. I told you the groups that I teach. I'll teach anybody, really. I've taught some not so liberty-minded groups too, which was very exciting. But I want you to know that I charge no speaking fees. Nobody is required to pay me to be here. I don't make any groups compensate me for travel, accommodations, or food. I am not independently wealthy, nor do I have a grant from the Koch brothers. But you see, we believe that the message is important. Important to the restoration of our republic and the future of our children. And we don't want there to be any excuses not to have this education. So it's not going to cost you a dime to have me come teach in your schools or your groups or your churches. But what's it costing us to remain ignorant? And so I want to ask two things of you. I want you to please go to my website. I have a radio show that I do 5 days a week. Sunday is broadcast by Genesis Communications Network, but Monday through Friday is broadcast across the country in Canada and in the UK. You can catch my radio show, if it's not broadcast here locally, on my website. I have all my shows archived. I have articles. I have training videos. I'm on Facebook, where I make at least 3 posts a day on constitutional issues. I take contemporary issues and turn them into constitutional training sessions. Please go to the website. Sign up and you can get my ebook, In Defense of Liberty, from the website. Get my Liberty Alerts. And this week, we're doing something that we've only done one time before in 5 years. This year, this week, we are doing a fundraising drive. Because I go a lot of places that I can't afford to help me. I teach schools for free. And when I go to the schools, I give away my books. And in order for me to do that, I need your help. And so you can help this ministry. You can help me continue to teach and continue to give away these books to our kids. By purchasing the books in the back, or by giving us a donation. Every little bit helps. This is the first time in 5 years we've done this. The first time that we did a fundraiser was to buy all my radio equipment. And so I would just ask you to pray about helping us. I would ask you to pray for us. My husband is a pastor who is now involved with a mission team to Haiti. So he's not over a specific church. He's over a number of churches in Haiti with our mission team. And he goes there to Haiti several times a year and stays for several weeks at a time. And so we need your prayers. I want to thank the John Birch Society for bringing me in here today. I want to thank you guys for coming, because otherwise I'd be standing in an empty room talking anyway. So who do I give the microphone back? I say thank you.
Great job. Thank you very much. Well, you see why she got fired. Got fired at Melody. That's what the justice. Thank you.